down the debt. What's happened since then is we've gone back up, folks, and we're right now, our debt equals our GDP. You might be interested to know what's going on. Everybody's heard about Greece and the trouble, Italy, what's going on in Europe. The GDP relationship increased from 30% to 118% in Italy. Ours is now at 100%. And if you want it scary, if you want to understand how serious this is and why we need to act, look at those two numbers. Folks, America needs to act soon to get this problem turned around. If you haven't seen what this debt number looks like, this is the debt facing America. This is what we're doing to future generations in this country. The debt is $15 trillion. If you would like to put that in perspective, there's 310 million people in the country. By the way, I was a math teacher, sorry. The debt, I'm trying, though, to bring these big abstract numbers down to a point where we can kind of comprehend what's happening in this country. $48,000 for every man, woman, and child in a family of four, a group of four people is $192,000 of debt out there right now. Our checkbook's overdrawn. You hear about deficit. That means we're spending more money than what we're taking in. This year alone, folks, this year alone, we're going to spend $1.3 trillion more than we take in. And again, to kind of put that in perspective, that's $4,200 per person. Or if a family of four in America were to pay enough money just to balance the budget, they would need to pay $16,800 more in taxes. Now, everybody says you can't balance the budget. I love this discussion. You can't balance the budget. I get that everywhere I go, especially folks in the media tell me it just can't be done. I like to put that in perspective for you, too. If the federal government today spent $30,000 on behalf of every family of four or group of four people in America, is this making sense? The federal budget would be balanced. Folks, if the federal government spent only $30,000 on behalf of every group or family of four people in America, the federal budget would be balanced. They're spending 46, if you're interested. Now, the next thing that happens, I love these discussions, everybody says, we've got to fix entitlements, and everybody goes Social Security and Medicare. Now, I just want to real quick make sure that we understand that when we talk about entitlements, that is typically mandatory spending in the budget. Social Security is $712 billion a year, Medicare is $522. But there's an entire section of mandatory spending or entitlements that has nothing to do with Social Security or Medicare. And that includes all kinds of things that are almost hard, that are almost incomprehensible. Medicaid, you've heard of course, strategic oil reserve is in there, crop guarantee for CRP program, crop insurance, loans to students, it's amazing what's all in there. So when we talk about entitlement reform, there's a lot of things other than Social Security and Medicare that we need to be talking about, and believe me, we're going to as we go forward. The first one a lot of people talk about is Social Security. They say everything's got to be fixed, you got to start with Social Security. I'd like you to know that Social Security this year is taking in about $781 billion. This includes interest on the trust fund. They're spending about $712. So there's a surplus in Social Security this year of about $68 billion. This is not the heart and soul of the problem facing the budget. Next. I'm bouncing through these with a lot of numbers, but I'm trying to give you a flavor for what we're really looking at. The Social Security Trust Fund has a current balance of $2.6 trillion in non-negotiable treasury bonds. The problem with Social Security is we have to be able to make good on that money that's in the quote savings account. By the way, that number is going to $3.6 trillion. So if you're picturing this, the savings account where the non-negotiable treasury bonds are for Social Security, over the next 10 years, that number is growing substantially if we don't. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on Medicare because if I do, it's going to spend the rest of the night. But I will say this. The biggest problem in Medicare is that they passed Part D, and you can debate the benefits or not benefits, but they passed it without any way to pay for it. Part D is going from $67 billion to $156 billion, 2.5-fold increase over the next 7 or 8 years. Folks, it's staggering. So you can debate the merits of Part D, and I think we should do that, and I think we should weigh the value of Part D against other things in government, but you can't just go, we're going to do everything. You've got to put it in perspective to a point where you have the ability to pay for what you're doing. The other entitlement is 970, and I just want to make sure we've emphasized that enough so that when you hear about entitlement reform from me, you're going to be hearing about a lot of different things that relate to a lot of different areas as in the entitlement reform. Now, let's talk, you guys, about solutions. I'm a business guy. We're running for office. We know we've got this problem. We're spending more money than we're taking in, and I want to talk about what's necessary to fix the problem.
What's going on right now, this represents if the present law stays in place, and we've excluded Social Security, Obamacare, we've assumed Obamacare is going to be ended, and we've assumed that the 30% Medicare reduction is not going to, and reimbursement rate is not going to happen to destroy Medicare. So we've got a couple of assumptions in here, but this is present law, folks, if nothing changes. And this is what CBO or the scoring agencies would tell us they expect revenue to do over that period of time. You get the idea that this distance in here, that's the deficit, folks. That's what we're spending more than what we're taking in. There is no end in sight to this thing, except that eventually you're going to not show up to lend us this money that we need to keep it going. That's Greece, that's Italy, that's those other countries. So conceptually, if you get this idea, this deficit just basically goes on forever until they quit lending us the money and we're forced to do something like the other countries. Now let me show you what we need to do. And it's pretty straightforward. And by the way, when I got all done doing this, it's almost exactly the same chart that I presented back in the middle 90s when we were facing very similar economic problems in this country. If you take this growth rate that's of spending that's going up at about twice the rate of inflation, and you just simply bring that down, you just let it grow up 1%, we're going to balance the budget in 5 years. Folks, if we just slow the growth rate of spending, now personally, I want you to know where I come from. This is not what I would do. This is what I perceive to be politically possible to get done. If it was me, we'd be bringing government spending down, because I think government is out of control. I think it's too big, and I think it should be a lot smaller. But what you're seeing in this presentation is you're seeing what I think we can actually get done out in Washington, D.C. And I say this not based on what I hypothetically hope to do, but I say it based on the experience I had there the last time when we actually accomplished this sort of thing, and in fact, the lines did cross. And one more thing that I think is really important. You want a dream? You want a big dream for the future of the United States of America? Here's my dream. My dream is that we pay our debt off and we pass this great nation on to our children debt-free. That's my dream. And in order to... What's significant in this plan is that if we can accomplish this, if we can get that discipline that's necessary to bring this spending under control in Washington, D.C., and then we can maintain some semblance of that discipline afterwards, the revenue lines are going to keep going up, and we will, in fact, create the space in between here where we will start paying down the debt. Now, I'm going to tell you what happened the last time. The last time we started doing this, and when the government quit taking the money, remember, when government spends more money than it has, that $1.3 trillion, they're borrowing that money, and it's not available for you and for me and for other people in the private sector to borrow. When the budget got close to balance before, and the private sector could then borrow that money instead of the public sector, this revenue line went through the roof because our economy exploded. People wanted to work, they started paying taxes, businesses were profitable because they could grow and expand. Private sector grew, and we solved our economic problems to the point where the revenues grew faster, not because of higher taxes, but because of economic growth and development in our country. Now, I can go on forever, but I think what I'd like to do instead is probably just talk to you last two. I just want to show you. I just want you to know we have already laid out 82 specific line item reductions in government spending, adding up to $2 trillion total, and I could talk a lot about these. Some of them are things like limousines that have increased in 73% since Barack Obama took office. I think limousines are for proms and for weddings. They probably have not to be riding around Washington in them. We've got liaisons with Hollywood people, but some of them are much more substantive in terms of dollars, like eliminating ethanol subsidies, for example. There's a lot of things like that in here. But I want you to know we've already taken the first step. There's 82 on here, it's $2 trillion total. Lots more coming. Endorsements, you've already talked about a little bit. We really appreciate Senator Rand Paul. It's been great to work with. Senator DeMint is wonderful. And if anybody wonders how you get these endorsements, I just want you to know that we were out there. These guys are not easy. They are like this, in your face, asking you questions to see whether or not you have a clue about what you're talking about before they actually get on board with you. So we very much appreciate their endorsements. I look forward to working with all three of them, as well as Ron Johnson from Wisconsin.